Random House Audio presents A Mercy, read for you by the author, Toni Morrison, with an exclusive author interview immediately following the program.
Don't be afraid. My telling can't hurt you, in spite of what I have done, and I promise to lie quietly in the dark, weeping perhaps, or occasionally seeing the blood once more, but I will never again unfold my limbs to rise up and bear teeth. I explain. You can think what I tell you a confession if you like, but one full of curiosities, familiar only in dreams, and during those moments when a dog's profile plays in the steam of a kettle, or when a corn husk doll, sitting on a shelf, is soon splaying in the corner of a room, and the wicket of how it got there is plain. Stranger things happen all the time, everywhere, you know. I know you know. One question is, who is responsible? Another is, can you read? If a peahen refuses to brood, I read it quickly, and sure enough, that night, I see a Menomai standing hand in hand with her little boy, my shoes jamming the pocket of her apron. Other signs need more time to understand. Often there are too many signs, or a bright omen clouds up too fast. I sort them and try to recall, yet I know I am missing much, like not reading the garden snake crawling up to the door saddled to die. Let me start with what I know for certain. The beginning begins with the shoes. When a child, I am never able to abide being barefoot and always beg for shoes, anybody's shoes, even on the hottest days. My mother, Amenemai, is frowning, is angry at what she says are my pretty five ways. Only bad women wear high heels. I am dangerous, she says, and wild. But she relents and lets me wear the throwaway shoes from Senora's house. Pointy toe. One raised heel broke, the other worn, and a buckle on top. As a result, Lina says, my feet are useless, will always be too tender for life, and never have the strong soles, tougher than leather, that life requires. Lina is correct. Florens, she says, it's 1690. Who else these days has the hands of a slave and the feet of a Portuguese lady? So when I set out to find you, she and mistress give me sir's boots that fit a man, not a girl. They stuff them with hay and oily corn husks and tell me to hide the letter inside my stocking, no matter the itch of the sealing wax. I am lettered, but I do not read what mistress writes, and Lina and Sorrow cannot. But I know what it means to say to any who stop me. My head is light with the confusion of two things: hunger for you, and scare if I am lost. Nothing frights me more than this errand, and nothing is more temptation. From the day you disappear, I dream and plot to learn where you are and how to be there. I want to run across the trail, through the beech and white pine, but I'm asking myself, which way? Who will tell me? Who lives in the wilderness between this farm and you, and will they help me or harm me? What about the boneless bears in the valley? Remember how when they move, their pelts sway as though there is nothing underneath, their smell belying their beauty, their eyes knowing us from when we are beasts also. You telling me that is why it is fatal to look them in the eye. They will approach, run to us, to love and play, which we misread and give back fear and anger. Giant birds also are nesting out there, bigger than cows, Lina says. And not all natives are like her, she says. So watch out. A praying savage, neighbors call her, because she is once church-going. Yet she bathes herself every day, and Christians never do. Underneath, she wears bright blue beads and dances in secret at first light when the moon is small. More than fear of loving bears or birds bigger than cows, I fear pathless night. How, I wonder, can I find you in the dark? Now, at last, there is a way. I have orders. It is arranged. I will see your mouth and trail my fingers down. You will rest your chin in my hair again while I breathe into your shoulder. In and out. In and out. I am happy the world is breaking open for us. Yet its newness trembles me. To get to you, I must leave the only home, the only people I know. Lina says, from the state of my teeth, I am maybe 7 or 8 when I am brought here. We boil wild plums for jam and cake 8 times since then. So I must be 16. Before this place, I spend my days picking okra and sweeping tobacco sheds, my nights on the floor of the cookhouse with a minimai. We are baptized and can have happiness when this life is done. The Reverend Father tells us that. Once every 7 days, we learn to read and write. We are forbidden to leave the place, so the 4 of us hide near the marsh. My mother, me, her little boy, and Reverend Father. He is forbidden to do this, but he teaches us anyway, watching out for wicked Virginians and Protestants who want to catch him. If they do, he will be in prison or pay money or both. He has 2 books and a slate. We have sticks to draw through sand, pebbles to shape words on smooth, flat rock. When the letters are memory, we make whole words. I am faster than my mother, and her baby boy is no good at all. Very quickly, I can write from memory the Nicene Creed, including all of the commas. Confession we tell, not write, as I am doing now. I forget almost all of it until now. I like talk, Lina talk, stone talk, even sorrow talk. Best of all is your talk. At first, when I am brought here, I don't talk any word. All of what I hear is different from what words mean to a Minamai in me. Lina's words say nothing I know, nor mistresses. Slowly, a little talk is in my mouth and not on stone. Lina says the place of my talking on stone is Mary's land, where Sir does business. So that is where my mother and her baby boy are buried, or will be, if they ever decide to rest. Sleeping on the cookhouse floor with them is not as nice as sleeping in the broken sleigh with Lina. In cold weather, we put planks around our part of the cowshed and wrap our arms together under pelts. We don't smell the cow flops because they're frozen and we are deep under fur. In summer, if our hammocks are hit by mosquitoes, Lina makes a cool place to sleep, out of branches. You never like a hammock, and prefer the ground, even in rain, when Sir offers you the storehouse. Sorrow no more sleeps near the fireplace. The men helping you, Will and Scully, never live the night here, because their master does not allow it. You remember them, how they would not take orders from you until Sir makes them. He could do that, since they are exchange for land under lease from Sir. Lina says Sir has a clever way of getting without giving. I know it is true, because I see it forever and ever. Me watching, My mother listening, her baby boy on her hip. Senor is not paying the whole amount he owes to sir. Sir saying he will take instead the woman and the girl, not the baby boy, and the debt is gone. Aminamai begs no. Her baby boy is still at her breast. Take the girl, she says. My daughter, she says. Me, me. Sir agrees and changes the balance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.